फ्रेंड्स, टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट ऑडियो बुक द गो गिवर, अ लिटिल स्टोरी अबाउट अ पावरफुल बिजनेस आइडिया बाय बॉब बर्ग एंड जॉन डेविड मैन। फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज द बुक विच इज हाईली रिकमेंडेड एंड द बुक कंटेन द पावर ऑफ गिविंग एंड दिस इज द ग्लोबल बेस्ट सेलर बुक।
द फर्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ द बुक इज द गो गेटर। इफ देयर वाज एनीवन एट द Clason Hill Trust Corporation who was a go-getter, it was Joe. He worked hard, worked fast and was headed for the top. At least that was his plan. Joe was an ambitious young man aiming for the stars. Still, sometimes it felt as if the harder and faster he worked, the further away his goals appeared. For such a dedicated go-getter, it seemed like he was doing a lot of going but not a lot of getting. Work being as busy as it was, though, Joe didn't have much time to think about that, especially on a day like today, a Friday, with only a week left in the quarter and a critical deadline to meet, a deadline he couldn't afford not to meet. Today, in the waning hours of the afternoon, Joe decided it was time to call in a favor. So he placed a phone call, but the conversation was not going well. Carl, tell me you are not telling me this. Joe took a breath to keep the desperation out of his voice. Neil Hansen? Who the heck is Neil Hansen? Well, I don't care what he is offering. We can meet those specs. Wait. Clement Carl, you owe me one. You know you do. Hey, who saved your bacon on the hodge account? Carl, hang on, Carl. Joe clicked off the talk button on his cordless phone and made himself calmly set down the instrument. He took a deep breath. Joe was desperately trying to land a large account, an account he felt he richly deserved. One he needed if he wanted to make his third quarter quota. Joe had just missed his quota in the first quarter and again in the second. Two strikes. Joe didn't even want to think about a third. Joe, you okay? A voice asked. Joe looked up into the concerned face of his co-worker, Melanie Matthews. Melanie Matthews was a well-meaning, genuinely nice person, which was exactly why Joe doubted she would survive long in a competitive environment like the seventh floor, where they both worked. Yeah, he said. Was the Carl Kellerman on the phone about the BK account? Joe sighed. Yeah, he didn't need to explain. Everyone on the floor knew who Carl Kellerman was. He was a corporate broker looking for the right firm to handle an account Joe had nicknamed the Big Kahuna, or BK for short. According to Carl, the boss at Big Kahuna didn't think Joe's firm had the clout and leverage to put the deal together. Now some character he would never heard of had underbid and outperformed him. Carl claimed there was nothing he could do about it. I just don't get it, Joe said. I am so sorry, Joe, said Melanie. Hey, sometimes you eat the beer. He flashed a confident grin, but all he could think about was what Carl had said. As Melanie walked back to her desk, Joe sat lost in thought, clout and leverage. Moments later, he leaped up and walked over to Melanie's desk. Hey, Mel. She looked up. Do you remember talking with Gus and other day? Something about a big wheel consultant giving a talk somewhere next month. You called him the captain or something? Melanie smiled. Pinder the chairman? Joe snapped his finger. That's it. That's the guy. Where is his last name? Melanie frowned. I don't think. She shrugged. No, I don't think I have ever heard it mentioned. Everyone calls him the chairman. Or just Pinder. Why? You want to go hear the talk? Yeah, maybe. But Joe was not interested in some lecture happening a month away. He was interested in only one thing, and that one thing needed to happen by the following Friday. Then the third quarter came to an end. I was thinking, this guy is a real heavy hitter, right? Charges huge consulting fees. Works only for the biggest and best firms. Major cloud. I know we could handle the BK account. but I am gonna need some big guns to win that deal back. I need leverage. Any idea how I can get aligned to this chairman guy's office? Melanie looked at Joe as if he were proposing to wrestle a grizzly bear. You are just going to call him up? Joe shrugged. Sure, why not? Melanie shook her head. I have no idea how to contact him. Why don't you ask Gus? As Joe headed back to his desk, he wondered how Gus had managed to survive his loan at Clayson Hill Trust. He never saw him do any actual work. Yes, Gus had an enclosed office. While Joe, Melanie and a dozen others shared the open space of the 7th floor, some said Gus had gotten his office because of seniority. Others said he would earn it on merit. According to office rumors, it had been years since Gus had sold a single account, and management kept him on priority out of loyalty. There were also whispers about Gus that went to the other extreme, that he had been super successful in his younger days and was now an independently wealthy eccentric who slashed his millions away in mattresses while living a pensioner's lifestyle. Joe didn't believe the rumors. He was pretty sure Gus brought in some accounts, but it was hard to picture him as a sales superstar. Gus dressed like a high school English teacher and reminded Joe more of a retired country doctor than of an active businessman. With his relaxed, easy manner, his long, rambling phone conversation with potential clients, and his erratic extended vacation, Gus seemed like a relic of times long past, hardly a go-getter. Joe stopped at Gus's open door and knocked softly. "Come on in, Joe," came the reply. "So you want to call right now and try to get in to see the man himself?" Gus thumbed carefully through his large Rolodex, found the dog-eared card he was searching for, and copied the phone number onto a small slip of paper, which he then handed to Joe. He watched as Joe took the paper and punched in the number on his cordless phone. "On a Friday afternoon," Joe grinned. "Yep, I am going to do exactly that." Gus nodded thoughtfully. "One thing I have to say about you, Joe, you have got ambition, and I admire that." Gus absent-mindedly figured a meerschaum pipe as he talked. "If there is anyone on this floor who is a go-getter, it's you." Joe was touched. "Thanks, Gus." He headed back to his desk. From behind him, Gus called out, "Don't thank me yet." After a single ring, Joe was greeted by a cheerful voice belonging to a woman who identified herself as Brenda. He introduced himself, told her he needed to see the chairman, and then readied himself to parry her stonily. Instead, she shocked him by saying, "Of course, he can meet with you. Can you come by tomorrow morning?" "Tomorrow?" he stammered. "On a Saturday?" "Yes, if that works with you. Is 8 o'clock too early?" Joe was stunned. Don't you need to check with him first?" "Oh no," came her unruffled reply. "Tomorrow morning will be fine." There was a brief silence. Joe wondered if she had him confused with someone else, someone this Pinder character actually knew. "Ma'am," he finally managed to say, you know this is my first time meeting with him, right?" "Of course," she replied cheerfully. "You have heard about his trade secret and you want to learn about it." "Well, yes, that's it, more or less," he replied. "Trade secret?" The man was willing to share his trade secret. He could hardly believe his good fortune. "He will meet with you one time," continued Brenda. "After that, if you agree to his conditions, he will want to set up additional appointments to actually show you the secret." "Conditions?" Joe was crestfallen. He was sure these conditions would involve a stiff consulting fee or retainer he couldn't afford. And even if he could, it might require the kind of high-level credentials Joe certainly didn't have. Was it even worth it to go on, or should he cut his losses and find a graceful way to back out now? "Of course," he replied. "Oh, and what are his conditions again?" "You will have to hear that directly from the old man," she said with a giggle. Joe took down the address she gave him, mumbled his thanks and clicked off the phone. In less than 24 hours, he was going to meet with what had she called him, the old man, and why had she giggled when she said that?